Taking into account the time value of money is something that we often need to do in financial models. So if you know that the payment is going to be regular and you know what that amount is going to be, then you can just use the PV function. So we can just put in a rate. We can say, for example, it's going to be 6 years. It's going to be a regular payment of $500. And we are going to receive $22,500 at the end of that time period. So that is going to give us $19,328. Most of the time, though, in models, we have it laid out. And so we like to be able to see what those values are. So if we have these cash flow values here, we can just use an NPV function to say, this is my rate here, and these are the amounts that I'm going to receive over the next 6 years. So this is $23,000 because we are including that $500 payment in the final year. So the NPV function is going to give us the same as if we were to use a PV function. Let's look at a practical example. So if you were considering purchasing an asset and you know that that's going to save you money over the next 5 years, you want to work out or you want to use this to make a decision whether we should buy it or not. So you know what your weighted average cost of capital is, and that is the discount rate that we're going to use. So that is how much it costs us to have money. So we know what we've laid out the values here. The total amount is 18,171, but we know that we need to pay 6.2% every year that we have that money outstanding, that we don't receive it. So we can again use the NPV function to calculate this, and the rate is the WACC. And that is going to give us a net present value of $3,168. So theoretically, the decision is that we should go ahead. However, though, you've got to think about the timing or the way that the NPV function works. What it does is it assumes that that $69,500 is paid at the end of the period, which is not going to happen for another 12 months. So what would be more accurate is if I were to exclude that first field from the calculation and I was simply to add that in like that. So that's going to change the number just a little bit. Now, this is quite... It's fairly rudimentary because it's annual using the NPV function. If you do know exactly the dates when that cash is going to occur, then you might consider using the XNPV function, which is a little bit more accurate. So here we've got exactly the same amount of cash flows. Again, $18,171. You can see it down here. And I'm going to use the XNPV this time. So again, the rate is 6.2, the values are here, and the corresponding date. So we can see that the dates are not exactly regular. The first two are 6 months apart, and then it's annual after that. And that gives us a very different number. Now you need to understand how the XNPV works. So the XNPV does not discount that first amount. So it assumes that the date that we are discounting to is the 1st of January 25. So the basis is a little bit different. But the numbers that we get are, a little bit different. So the theory is, of course, that if it's a positive NPV, you should go ahead with the project. If it's a negative NPV, you shouldn't. Of course, in a financial model, there might be a little bit more to it, but it's certainly a very useful way of calculating and making decisions in your financial models. Another really useful function that you might need to know for your career in finance is the IRR. And what the IRR is calculates the internal rate of return. So that is, what is the return of these cash flows on an annual basis on average. So in this example, if you were to outlay $75,000 in the first year and then you were to receive these returns over the subsequent 5 years, what is that as a return on an annual basis? And we can calculate this just using an IRR. The guess, if you leave that blank, it will default to just 10%. So most of the time you can just leave the guess blank. And so that's going to give us 3.18%, which is, you know, a pretty small return. Again, just like we did with the NPV, if you know what the exact dates are, you can use the XIRR instead. And that is going to give us quite a different and slightly more accurate number. So those are a couple of functions that are going to be really useful for you in your financial modeling career or just in your career as an analyst or in finance.